Welcome to a special collaborative presentation featuring author Sarah Thornton as part of the Dallas Museum of Art's Arts and Letters Live Series and the Nasher Sculpture Center's 360 Speaker Series. I'm Carolyn Best, Director of Programming and Arts and Letters Live at the DMA, and on behalf of both institutions, I'd like to say how glad we all are that you could be with us this evening.
Welcome, welcome. I am Anna Smith, Curator of Education at the Nasher. In addition to Sarah Thornton, we're fortunate to be joined this evening by Nasher Sculpture Center Director Jeremy Strick and by Maxwell Anderson, the Eugene McDermott Director of the Dallas Museum of Art. Mr. Strick will engage Ms. Thornton in conversation towards the end of our program, and Mr. Anderson will offer us an introduction to her fascinating work. During this evening's question and answer session, please feel free to raise your hand and a staff member will bring you a microphone. We do ask that you stand up as you speak so that the author can see who is asking the question. After the event ends, you're all invited to meet Sarah Thornton near the museum store for a book signing where copies of her books, 33 Artists in 3 Acts, and 7 Days in the Art World are available for purchase. I've really been enjoying my own copy, and I know they'd make wonderful gifts for the art lover on your holiday list. So hint, hint. And now, to introduce tonight's program, please welcome to the stage Maxwell Anderson.
You know, it's so many artists, 33 of them, 3 acts, 3 people introducing Sarah. So clearly she warrants our collective attention and appreciation. And I will join our previous 2 introducers to be the 3rd in line to welcome Sarah to Dallas, and very grateful to the Nasher and others in the Arts District in general for being so collaborative as we are in this neck of the woods. Sarah Thornton is a writer and sociologist of art. She has a bachelor's degree in art history and a PhD in sociology. And she's formerly the chief correspondent of contemporary art at The Economist. She's written for many, many other publications, including Art Forum, The Guardian, The New Yorker, and has contributed to broadcasts for BBC and NPR. She's a frequent guest speaker, giving talks across the world, participating in panels at art museums, universities, and literary festivals around the globe. Sarah's a Canadian who went on to Britain for a prestigious Commonwealth scholarship. And in that, she pursued a hierarchy study, a study of the hierarchies of coolness through a case study of dance clubs and raves. And it was published as Club Cultures, Music, Media, and Subcultural Capital. Her doctorate led the Daily Telegraph to dub her Britain's hippest academic. In 2008, she published 7 Days in the Art World. And it's a series, if you haven't read it, you must. It's a series of witty narratives that reveals the inner workings of artists, dealers, collectors, curators, and critics. And it was named by the New York Times one of the books of the year. It's an international hit. It's currently available in 17 languages as of this writing. About 5 years ago, Sarah began investigating the question, what's an artist? And following from that, how do artists command belief in their work? She wondered what artistic myths do they enliven or reject. And as part of that exploration, she traveled widely to 14 countries on 4 continents, interviewing and observing over 130 artists. And after that process, she came up with the structure and themes of the book, 33 Artists in 3 Acts. These 3 richly linked acts are politics, kinship, and craft. And Sarah's a masterful storyteller, as you will soon see, and she weaves stories of the various artists featured within each section. The book is both ambitious and entertaining, and it takes readers behind the scenes within a very extraordinary cast of living artists, from global superstars to unheralded teachers, to humanize and to demystify contemporary art. We watch Jeff Koons' duck questions about his persona and political leanings, listen to Lena and Grace Dunham talk about the creative strategies they learned from their artistic parents, the painter Tip Dunham and the photographer Laurie Simmons. We make ourselves comfortable in the idiosyncratic apartment of Maurizio Cattelan and snoop inside Cindy Sherman's cupboard of prosthetic noses and more. Booklist and Publishers Weekly have given 33 Artists in 3 Acts starred reviews, calling Thornton, quote, intrepid and inquisitive, and the book eye and mind opening. And Vanity Fair says, quote, Sarah Thornton's book takes one into the bullseye of the contemporary art world. What I especially like is how she tells us when her notably varied subjects disagree with her or would rather she weren't there at all. Most readers will be glad she was. Please join me in giving a warm welcome to Sarah Thornton.
Thank you very much, Maxwell. And thank you to Carolyn Bess and Anna Smith. And although he'll be up here on stage with me shortly, Jeremy Strick, just in case I fail to thank you later. It's wonderful to be here in Dallas. This is the fourth day the book is on sale, and I'm still learning how to distill 5 years of research and 100,000 words into a snappy 40-minute talk. But hopefully all will go well. I'll go straight to my first slide. A couple of artists who are in the book, just by way of example. On the left is Tammy Ray Carlin's self-portrait called I'm Dying Up Here. And when I saw the self-portrait, it captured my imagination and for the way it asked the questions that I was asking. The image invokes many of the ancillary expectations that befall artists, the pressure to speak, to be seen, to perform, to convince, to entertain. I first started asking the question, what is an artist, when I was researching 7 Days in the Art World, particularly when I was out in Los Angeles researching chapter 2, The Crit. And when I asked it there, I was often kind of laughed at. As a sociologist, and certainly for someone who studied hipness, as I did in my PhD, I seem immune to worrying about being uncool. Even though people dismiss this question as too obvious, and as one senior curator who teaches in one of Los Angeles' esteemed universities said to me, well, you know one when you see one. And of course, that led me to ask, well, what do they look like then? And there are moments where I do discuss artists' sartorial choices. This image also reminds me of the artist talk, that very particular breed of self-promotion in which artists present their best works and CV highlights in a way that is hopefully enabling to younger artists or illuminating to museum goers. I actually start off the book with a couple of artist talks. And I think, too, the kind of absurdity of this pink towel draped over her head, this kind of little girl's strawberry shortcake kind of towel, evokes for me the themes of, like, the difficulty of commanding credibility and being taken seriously and what seriousness means in the art world. It was actually chosen for the cover of the UK edition of the book. I actually love the American cover as well, which we'll end on. But just as a way of unraveling some of the themes through an image. One of the book's arguments is that an artist's work is not simply the isolated objects or artworks that they make, but the entire way they play their game. And I think this is also something evoked by this image. On the right, we have Katie Nolan, who, unless things change next week, is currently the world's most expensive living woman artist, despite the fact that she hasn't had a solo show since about 1996. And I was very pleased to be able to interview her for this book, as she hasn't given an interview in over a decade. One of the things that really intrigues me about her, and one of the reasons I wanted to speak to her, is because she's one of the few artists who's invoked her rights under the Visual Artists' Rights Act of 1990 that grants artists the right to prevent the use of their name in association with, quote, distorted, mutilated, or modified work that could prejudice their honor or reputation. In 2011, a work called Cowboy's Milking came up for sale, was coming up for sale at Sotheby's. It was estimated between $200,000 and $300,000, but it was slightly bent. And so Noland felt obliged to renounce her authorship of the work. And in so doing, the work that might have been worth as much as 300K or even more was worth nothing. This is illustrative of the power of an artist's name. And obviously, that's very determining in the marketplace where artist brands rule. But I think the way the whole art world works is very much around names. The solo shows, the dominant exhibition format of contemporary art museums, they generally obtain greater footfall than group shows. And the monograph is the dominant form of publication. Authorship is often, and not the only thing, but often what differentiates art from craft. The history of craft is a history of objects made by anonymous artisans. The history of art is a history of things made by people with names. One of the other theses of the book is that artists don't just make art. They create and preserve myths that give their work clout. I feel like I'm going against the grain of the dominant ideologies of the art world by saying this, which I think are kind of a hangover of formalist art histories. I studied art history and then I left that world for quite a while. When I came back into the art world and started researching 7 days, it was very clear to me at that time that the only really appropriate thing to write about was the work in the strict sense, the work within the frame or the work on the pedestal. People saw a lot of the cultural, social, and economic things swirling around the work as trivia of sorts. And certainly some art critics can be quite self-righteous about not being distracted by the behavior of talk of artists, although I'm not sure how they can avoid artists' words. So often nowadays, artworks enter the world surrounded in discourse, be they through interviews with the artist or press releases or what have you. And there's also an argument, too, that the cult of personality drags art into the arena of mindless popular culture. That may be the case, but I think it's also a fact that individual inanimate objects are easily ignored unless they're clustered in a branded oeuvre, an oeuvre with a backstory. And just a couple of quick examples from artists in the book. We have Yayoi Kusama on the left, who's, she's the oldest artist in the book, and I think that's one of the reasons the myths that surround her are probably from an older generation. She's, your classic crazy genius, I guess. On the right-hand side, we have Rashid Johnson. This particular work is called Self-Portrait as the Professor of Astronomy, Miscegenation, and Critical Theory at the New Negro Escapist and Athletic Club Center for Graduate Studies. I can never memorize that title. One day I'll get it. I think this piece comically underlines artists' strange range of knowledges. But it also evokes Rashid Johnson's particular family history, because his mother is a professor of African American studies, and as he put it to me, his family line is divided very much between a very well-educated black bourgeois side of the family, his mother's side, I think on that side, his grandfather, and I should have double-checked this. I think he was the first African-American to graduate from Harvard Medical School. And Rashid's brother went to Harvard and studied law. So on one side of the family, a very well-educated. On the other side, as he put it, his father's side of the family were Johnsons from Tennessee. Something that's being brought to the fore I think one thing I've found, and art historians have also found, is that self-portraiture tends to dominate in artists tend to do more self-portraiture when they're young, when they're kind of making their mark, staking their claim, and trying to garner attention for themselves. So my related arguments, an artist's work is not the isolated object, but the entire way they play their game. And artists don't just make art, but engender myths that give extra magic, kick, energy, authority, and believability to their work. I think this has probably been true in various kinds of ways since the Renaissance, but it was very much intensified by Marcel Duchamp. And certainly since 1917, when he upended a urinal. I've lived in Britain for so long, I occasionally say urinal, and it sounds terrible here, especially when I don't actually have a British accent. So excuse me if I do that again. I once gave a whole lecture to art students and said urinal the whole time. They thought I was nuts. So let's see. Yes, so the well-known story in 1917, Duchamp declared that an upended urinal was an artwork titled Fountain. In so doing, he claimed a godlike power for all artists to designate anything they chose as art. In so doing, I think he made belief a central artistic concern. 19th century painters face credibility issues, but this put credibility on the line in a very different way. Maintaining the authority to designate something as art is not easy, but it is essential now for artists. Especially now that the art world is when art has become a sphere where anything can be art, and there's no objective measurement of quality, arguably, so ambitious artists need to establish their own standards of excellence. Generating such standards requires not only immense self-belief, self-confidence, but the conviction of others. So, like competing deities, artists today need to perform in ways that yield a faithful following. We have on the left Duchamp's La Belle Hélène, where Man Ray has been enlisted as his assistant to take this portrait of Duchamp in drag in the form of Rose Célavie. And in this work, Duchamp is in the place we might find a brand, like Uncle Ben's rice. I don't think that's any accident. Here he's positioning himself as a creative director, architect, ideas man, and brand. I think that in the course of rejecting the handmade in favor of the ready-made, Duchamp began crafting, began crafting identities as well as ideas, and played around not just with the persona of Rose Célavie, but also, a wide range of series of self-portraits, including presenting himself as a con man in his wanted man poster. It doesn't seem to be an accident to me. That in all of this, that in shifting craftsmanship away from the making of the work, which is what the ready-made did, ironically, being an artist itself became a craft. On the right-hand side, we have Marina Abramović, and I think here she is performing The Artist is Present, which I'm sure you know she did at the Museum of Modern Art in New York a few years ago. I think the title says it all, really, in terms of the shift of the authority out of the object onto the artist. One of the things that I interviewed Marina after this performance and was very intrigued that she distinguished between her high self and her low self. Her high self was her performing self. And that felt kind of self-evident. But her low self, she was reluctant to describe to me, and I had to press her several times. And eventually she conceded that her low self was full of contradictions and things that you're ashamed of. And I prodded her some more, and then she said, well, I love fashion. In the 1970s, that made you a bad artist. And I think it's a throwaway line in one way, but it's also very telling. I don't think a love of cars and strip bars has ever had a commensurate effect on a male artist's credibility. And it is interesting that there's long, she's talking about the 70s, and I think probably until very recently, there was a very strong antagonism between art and fashion. Now they seem to be merging further, and who knows if that's the result of feminism or not. It would be a weird, odd outcome, perhaps, but you never know. Another argument is in the book is that being an artist is not a job, but an identity whose authority is hard won. And I think one of them, there are many different myths, often propagated by artists, about being an artist, like anyone can be an artist, or we're all artists already. And I just don't think that's true. It's actually extremely difficult to be an artist, particularly one who commands the belief of others. One can declare oneself an art. I mean, many people have a very difficult time declaring themselves an artist. Graduating with a BA or an MFA from an art school does not seem to be enough. And oftentimes, the identity can be contested over and over again. Frances Elise, a Belgian artist who lives in Mexico City, talked to me about how his kind of confidence around being an artist and his sense of self was very much rooted in being in Mexico City. And I quote, he said, I became an artist here. That has a lot to do with my dependence on this place. I don't have a past in the art field in Europe. And he actually did try to leave Mexico for a while and was keen to go back. It is certainly the case that artists displace themselves, usually to cities like New York, LA, or Berlin, and if they're in very small towns, just to the local big city. I think emigration helps them escape the burdens of their cultural heritage and to embrace identities that they might feel otherwise inhibited in assuming. That can even be the case with parents. Someone can declare themselves an artist, but do their parents believe they're an artist? This is actually something that comes up. Usually there are different external benchmarks, different benchmarks of validation that work for the artist, him or herself, be it, having a studio, getting a dealer, being included in their first museum show, and it varies hugely. And then, of course, a different set of criteria for their parents. So here we have Francis Elise doing one of his actions in which he is selling his wares, so to speak, as a tourist amongst the tradesmen in the central square of of Mexico City. And certainly the role of the artist as a misfit non-worker forever on holiday is a theme that runs right through contemporary art and originates with Duchamp. On the right, we have Martha Rosler performing her cult classic Semiotics of the Kitchen from 1975. And you can see this on YouTube, along with a lot of other versions of Semiotics of the Kitchen, because it's become almost a YouTube meme to reperform it. You can see Barbie Semiotics of the Kitchen, amongst other things. Interestingly, in 1975, the critic writing for Art Forum suggested that this theme of the kitchen was evidence that Rosler was not a serious artist. Rosler was quite quick to declare that, in those days, women's issues weren't considered significant enough to inspire an artwork. And interestingly, she argues that nowadays, heftier themes can be perceived to be too grave for art. Seriousness swivels. And I quote, she says, "Today, art is supposed to be ambiguous or playful. So when a work deals with something like war, homelessness, it can step outside the bounds of what is considered art." And just so you don't think I'm making all of this up, I did interview 130 artists for the book in more geographical locations than this. The cities are the locations of the scenes, and the darker shaded countries are the ones from the countries of origin of the artists who ended up in the book. The book is titled 33 Artists in Three Acts. There's actually only 29 artists. Gertrude Stein wrote a libretto called Four Saints in Three Acts, but there were actually 20 saints in the libretto. So I thought if she could do it, I could do it, and it could be a little homage to her. Anyway, I actually did do research in Argentina and Korea and a few other countries here, but here are the basics. In the course of doing my interviews, I, asked repeatedly my key questions: what is an artist? What kind of artist are you? What do you think is credibility? What do you think about terms like credibility, authenticity, things like that? Asked about myths they didn't believe in and wanted to avoid, that kind of thing. My criteria for including artists was very, very, very difficult actually to do my cull, but my criteria resembled those of both a curator and a casting director. On the one hand, the book's curated insofar as it was important that their work be relevant to my themes of politics, kinship, and craft, and also the overarching question of what is an artist, and also kind of generally relevant to, for lack of a better cliche, our times. But I also deployed the kind of mindset of a casting director as well. There are certain artists in the book who are slippery and perhaps give me questions that maybe I don't believe in fully, and my reader can be the judge. Hard to tell. But for the most part, I was keen to have artists who wanted to collaborate with me, who wanted to tackle these questions. And the book is biased towards, very articulate people. That doesn't mean that everyone in the book is very chatty. Cindy Sherman is not someone who relishes giving interviews, and it took me a very long time to see her. I asked very early on. She was on the top of one of the artists on the top of my list when I started thinking about this book, probably for obvious reasons related to her use of herself in the work. She'd read 7 Days in the Art World, but as it came back to me through someone working at Metro Pictures, she said, "Oh yeah, I've read 7 Days. I actually like the book, but I have no interest in talking to her." No. Lucky for me, I artists come under pressure to promote their retrospectives. So I went back to her when the MoMA New York show was looming, and got in and said, "I'd like to interview you for the book, but I'll also write a piece for The Economist." And she then gave me a really wonderful interview, and and even saw me a second time when she was installing the same show at SF MoMA, and I must say, I wish I could have seen it here too. Yes. So, what else? The other thing perhaps I can just say about the artists in the book is that the mean year of birth of the artists included is 1960. And I did actually interview younger artists, but found that I wanted to make geographical comparisons and to include a really wide-ranging age demographic didn't really work. And I did my PhD in the sociology of youth, and I just felt it had emergent art. Emergent artists would kind of required being a separate book. So most of the artists in the book have at least 20 years experience being an artist. But it doesn't necessarily mean that they make a living from their work. In each act, there is an artist with a day job. Most of them are teachers. Professors of some kind, or a high school teacher in one instance. And what else can I tell you? The other thing is, I mean, it's impossible to be representative, I think. It's not like anyone is standing in for a type, because anyone who's a type is kind of maybe not performing the role so well, you know, if it feels like a stereotype, it might not be so credible. But I did try to gesture to some of the diversity in the field between entertainer and academic, materialist and idealist, narcissist and altruist, loner and collaborator. And then Max already mentioned my three themes, and here are just, you know, picking one artist out from each act. Politics in the broadest sense. It's about artists' ethics, their attitudes to power and responsibility, paying particular attention to human rights and freedom of speech. Wengeshi Mutu, whose work is about the politics of beauty, as she sees it, is one of the artists in Act One. One of the things that I found very fascinating speaking to her is that she's a Kenyan-born artist based in Brooklyn, and in her mother tongue, Kikuyu, there is no word for artist. The closest term is magician, or a person who uses objects and imbues them with meaning and power. And that sounds like a ready-made to me. I thought that was quite interesting. Also, when I asked her what kind of artist she felt that she was, she said she was a tattletale. And that she was, you know, the one who divulged the family secrets. And I particularly enjoy that response because that's what I feel my role is in the art world. So Kinship investigates artists' relationships with their peers, muses, and supporters with an eye on competition, collaboration, and ultimately love. Cindy Sherman's the extreme loner in the bunch. Her assistant isn't even allowed in the studio. She has to work remotely. And Cindy, for the most part, doesn't like anyone occasionally, she said, a boyfriend might see her involved in making a work, but otherwise she does it all herself, the makeup, the clothes, the lighting, clicking the camera, the post-production, absolutely everything. And here, as a demonstration of her kinship, you know, it feels like she's cloned a family. And one of the interesting conversations I have with her during installation at SF MoMA is about, you know, her characters looking related in some way, shape, or form. And then craft is about artists' skills and all aspects of making artworks from conception through execution to marketing strategies. My definition of craft is very broad, really all the skills required to be a contemporary artist today. And Grayson Perry, very well known in Britain, not so well in the US, started out as a potter and became famous in Britain when he won the Turner Prize in 2003 and announced on national television that it was about time a transvestite potter won the Turner Prize. Interestingly, his win was very controversial within the London art world and not actually that popular. And he, in this, now I don't know how to use the pointer. I don't know if you can see it, but there's a sound, a blurb on the, is this on? No, okay, I'll stay here. There's a speech bubble at the top of that pot, and I believe it says, now they've awarded the Turner Prize to someone who is not really an artist. And it's interesting, the kind of, you know, him reacting to the vibe in his local art world. And I think that there, you know, he's a heterosexual transvestite, which sometimes throws people off. But I think principally, because I was interviewing a lot of artists at the time, the chief problem was that he was a ceramicist. And at that time, there was still a lot of value judgment made in terms of the hierarchy of the decorative arts and the crafts. For Perry, he sees the split between art and craft as involving class. And I quote him, he says, "Whereas a craftsman is a worker, a painter is often just an incredible craftsman in a suit jacket." And he argues that despite its high status, most painting today is just craft. And I quote, he says, "Painting is locked into a tradition. It is very difficult to be original unless you can find a micro niche. And then it's difficult to step outside your niche because the territory on either side is already inhabited by another artist with his own micro niche." So one of the things that's not so typical about this book is that I insist on comparing and contrasting artists. And each act has recurring characters who are kind of pitted against each other. And so my foils for Act One, politics, are Ai Weiwei and Jeff Koons. They are almost the same age. They both use ready-mades, both very influenced by Duchamp, both use the media like nobody else, but Ai Weiwei politicizes everything he touches, and Koons would prefer to avoid politics at all costs. And so, you know, there's so much written about Koons, and I thought it was interesting to look at him through this filter. And I think Ai Weiwei's work is often, and we saw this when his, in terms of the critical reaction to his Hirshhorn retrospective, Roberta Smith and Peter Sheldahl both had very, oddly, my question, what is an artist, came up in their reviews, which is very unusual. And it was because they were tackling the issue, Ai Weiwei, is he an artist or a politician? An artist or an activist? And that is one of the boundaries that often demarcates artists from non-artist. You know, are you an artist or are you a didactic illustrator? One of the ideologies. When I asked Ai Weiwei what is an artist, and he you know, gives about 3 interviews a day and is rarely at a loss for words, he couldn't answer me right away. It's a tough question. And he started telling me the long story of his father, who trained as a painter, and then being put in prison by the Chiang Kai-shek government. And because he had no access to materials, he became a poet. And then was out of prison for a while, and then fell afoul of the Mao government, was deemed a rightist, and exiled to the far remote provinces of China to clean latrines for 18 years. And this was were the circumstances in which Ai Weiwei grew up, and he, you know, wound up his story saying that, you know, he had grown up seeing his father as an enemy of the state. So I then kind of assumed that he told me this anecdote in a response to this question. So I said, so is an artist an enemy of the state? And he paused and he said, no, the artist is an enemy of general sensibilities. Which is a kind of romantic avant-garde notion of an artist, and perhaps one that is easier to enliven in a country like China with no freedom of speech and no democracy, and perhaps one that is tougher in American culture where pinning down the general sensibilities is quite difficult, or can be, and when the art world can accept all manner of transgression. Kuhn's, by contrast, his philosophy, quite different from being an enemy of general sensibilities. He often talks about his work as a celebration of general sensibilities, it being about acceptance. And here we have there are so many works from Kuhn's that you could include. The legacy of his self-portraiture is fascinating, but I just picked this one out as a contrast to Ai Weiwei because he just looks like such a good boy. His well-mannered smile. This is definitely a portrait of the artist, an artist who knows how to be very discreet. And these are just a couple of more artists in that part of the book, Gabriel Orozco and Eugenio Ditborn. In the kinship section, the theme of family gives rise to clusters rather than an antagonistic pairing. And so I have the entire Dunham-Simmons family, including Lena Dunham, who in the course of the book becomes famous through her program Girls and wins a Golden Globe, and her younger sister, Grace. It was very hard for me to find an artist couple. I was keen to have a pair with comparable levels of recognition. And so often it's the case that one artist lives in the shadow of a more celebrated other, a significant other. Also, I interviewed various artists, and I had one artist couple only wanted to be interviewed apart and not together, and another artist couple only wanted to be interviewed together. And I was very glad that Tip, as Carroll Dunham's called, and Laurie were willing to be flexible and open and even have disagreements with each other in front of me. A lot of the conversations there become quite intimate. I'm very interested in artists' self-confidence and self-belief, and I'll just read you a couple of paragraphs or a couple of quotes from them on this topic, partly because they contrast so dramatically. So Simmons, when I ask her about weathering the storm of insecurities and anxieties, she says, "When you are younger, you think about eradicating self-doubt. But as you age, you understand that it is part of the rhythm of being an artist. As I get older, I have developed my ability to examine self-doubt in private, to play around with it rather than push it away." Dunham, by contrast, experiences his uncertainty as a strange mixture of self-loathing and megalomania. He says, quote, "Humans set up hierarchies and we are constantly judging. In the morning, you tell yourself you're a horrible artist. In the afternoon, you might feel like a god. By dinner, you're a lesser angel." And then here are another couple of artists in this part of the book, both of whom have day jobs. Jennifer Dalton. This piece on the left is from a series of 21 drawings, kind of made out to be like a kind of ultra-feminine handmade PowerPoint presentation. It's based on internet research with 850 artists, And remarkably, she did find that she's asked the question, you know, correlating basically men and women artists with and without kids in relation to how many of them have gallery representation. And perhaps not surprisingly, women without kids and men without kids, the orange and red blocks, are comparable. And not surprisingly, too, women with kids, the little yellow stump there, much less likely to have gallery representation. But it did surprise me that having kids was so great for a man's career, because that's what you see with the blue. So when she asked the question, will having children hurt my art career? The response is, not if you're a man. And those are some of the themes brought up in their scene, because Jennifer Dalton and William Pajita are occasional collaborators, so although these two works are individual works by them, they also work together. And I just think the Pajita work on the right is very funny almost all the way through, you know, and obviously gendered in a very different way. His checklist for an artist assistant, preferably female, hot, ugly men okay, going down the list, I'll let you read it. Non-judgmental. It just, the whole thing makes me laugh. Smart, but not too smart. So Act Three, craft, is about the real skills that artists need in the real world. Today, and definitely explores this broader definition of an artist's work, which includes making artworks. That's still the most important thing, but also dealing with museums, overseeing the production of catalogs, teaching, dealing with the press, hosting collectors in your studio. And I'm certainly very aware when I go into a studio with into the studio of an artist with high levels of recognition, they're so used to having studio visitors that the tape starts rolling almost right away. You get the story of their work, in most instances anyway, and usually I have to kind of like politely listen for a little bit and then cut them off and ask them a left-field question coming from a different direction to get them, you know, off their script, so to speak. So here we have Damien Hirst in the midst of a midlife crisis, I think. That moment when he might have had a crisis of belief in his Duchampian mode of working with ready-mades, from sharks and formaldehyde tanks through pill cabinets. Pill cabinets are not ready-mades, but his early cabinets, his medicine cabinets, and used off-the-shelf packaging. In this part of the book, I do talk about the market, and it's kind of hard not to talk about the market with someone like Damien. I think Andrea is a good contrast for him. She's a feminist performance artist who teaches at UCLA. For me, she is very much the anti-Hirst. Whereas he has created done things like his Sotheby's sale titled Beautiful Inside My Head Forever, in which he took 200 artworks, over 200 artworks out of the studio straight onto the auction block. And it was celebrated and by some as a conceptual work in and of itself and as a landmark event in an artist taking control of his market. And then the other half of the art world seemed to think that he had ceased to be an artist at all. And it's interesting that those two thoughts can be going on simultaneously in different factions. But I actually am of the camp that, he may have ceased to be an artist. I'm not going to pass judgment on that one. But I did see the auction as a conceptual event, especially with a title like that. And Andrea Fraser has done works that similarly, put a flag in the sand at the other end of the spectrum. here she is performing official welcome, and actually in a moment she'll take off that bikini and will perform Hearst naked. But perhaps her more notorious work is one called Untitled. She titles all of her work, but that one has is specifically a generic. And that's where she solicited through her dealer, a collector to have sexual intercourse with her in front of a surveillance camera, and that resulted in a video. So, Andrea is, a lot of her work has been about being an artist, and is unpacking. She's the person who coined the term institutional critique, and one of the key institutions for her is the artist, him or herself. She's kind of the artist in the book who says a lot of things that I want to be said. That's partly because I studied this French sociologist called Pierre Bourdieu in the course of doing my PhD, and she is also a big Bourdieu fan, and so the kind of sociology, so our sociological backgrounds are very similar. When I asked her what is an artist, she said right out, an artist is a myth. Most artists internalize the myth in the process of their development and then strive to embody and perform it. One of the fun conversations we also have is about artists' fantasies of omnipotence as well. And I guess it's fitting that in a Duchampian world where artists have the godlike power to designate something as art, that fantasies of omnipotence might come to the fore. Quote you one moment. She says, and she explains it with recourse to childhood fantasies. She says, Freud talks about the artist being able to create his own world. And Winnicott, a British psychoanalyst, believed that infants initially experience the world as their own creation. Winnicott even wrote about this phase of development where babies experience this tremendous narcissistic insult when they are stripped of the fantasy of complete omnipotence. And so then I ask her, so do you dream of being a god? And she says, well, maybe the way babies do when they're worshipped by their parents. One of the core fantasies of artists is unconditional love, and the associated unconditional value attributed to anything that we produce is not first of all about money. It's about love, attention, recognition, regard, and freedom from shame. So my final slide. Oh, no. Penultimate. This is just a couple more artists in the book, in this part of the book, Craft. Two artists who work principally in video, or perhaps best known for video, but in very different ways, Mark Lee through appropriating images, and Isaac Julian through making his own. Now the final slide. So going back, to this thought about how artists don't just make art, but create and preserve myths that give clout to their work, and that being an artist is not just a job, but an identity that requires immense authority, it can be very difficult to maintain that authority. It can be absolutely exhausting to maintain that form of self-belief. And I think this might be in part behind Maurizio Cattelan's decision to retire from making art and retire as an artist. He is one of the recurring characters in the kinship section, and I should have mentioned that the Dunham-Simmons family are contrasted with Maurizio Cattelan and his brothers in crime, Francesco Bonomi and Massimiliano Gioni, and also Cindy Sherman. So there's kind of a larger cast of recurring characters in the kinship part of the book. At the beginning, in his first scene, he says, quote, we are constantly working on a tightrope. The more I go ahead, the higher the tightrope. If you fall from 3 meters up, you break your legs. But from 30 meters, all your problems are solved at once. And then, lo and behold, a few years later, for his Guggenheim retrospective, he hangs up all the work. You've slaughtered them in a kind of mass hanging. Oops. And I'll just finish on a quote before Jeremy takes the stage. On the right, we have Elm Green and Dragset's Gay Marriage, clearly a reference to Duchamp. And Elm Green and Dragset are an artistic duo who see themselves as each half an artist or a two-headed monster. But that doesn't mean they still can't disagree about what they think of the term artist and whether they identify with the term artist. And I'll just finish by reading a couple of paragraphs. So Elm Green says, "I don't have the taste in my mouth or the smell in my nose of being an artist. I'm a cultural producer." Dragset flicks his eyes to the sky and then looks to me for support. Quote, and he says, quote, "I'm an artist. I wouldn't call myself anything else, just as I'm gay and I wouldn't call myself queer. I remember very well the decision to accept myself as an artist. I had my 30th birthday in New York City where we had a residency. Up until that point, I had felt embarrassed. Then I thought, fuck it. I can be an artist just as much as anyone else." And then Elm Green, wanting to, you know, being mischievous, says, "These identity groups are so last century. You were a gay artist in the 20th century. I would say that we are far too busy to be artists. We make artworks, do a theatrical performance, publish a book, design a t-shirt, curate a show, so many things. We are like small mice avoiding being trapped or cornered. Our work is not about universal truths. All we do is tell small lies." And on that note, perhaps I could be joined.
Well, Sarah, thank you for that talk. That was terrific. And I have to say, the book is marvelous. It's both highly enjoyable and really provocative. So congratulations.
Thank you so much.
One thing I want to ask you just to start off, you spent 4 years and lots of miles looking to think about or answer the question, what is an artist? But before you started that process, you were no neophyte to the art world. You had spent 7 days in it.
Yes, 5 years researching 7 days. Oops, sorry, that's so loud.
So I'm just curious, over the 4 years spent on this project, did anything change for you? Did you come to a new understanding that you didn't possess when you started?
Absolutely. I mean, for me, what is an artist was a real question. I was confused. I wasn't sure. And it's interesting that Cattelan decided to retire in the course of the book, because it was when I met him in the summer of 2009 that I actually started puzzling over this role. He's a very self-conscious player. He's actually an autodidact. He's one of the few artists, he's one of not many artists who didn't go to art school, who are, you know, in that arena at that age group. Of course, over 60, you find quite a few artists who didn't go to art school. Under 55, the role is being professionalized, and artists are much more likely to have a degree of some sort. And so over the course of the book, I mean, I just think that, you know, there's no single answer to the question. If there was a single answer, you know, you'd write an article, not a book. And one of the wonderful things is the degree to which this role is so, you can customize it in so many different ways, and also it's so inclusive. So, you know, once you're kind of made your claim and you're accepted by society as an artist, you can then do a lot of different things. You know, the list that Elm Green itemizes. But being known in one of those other fields first can make it very hard to become an artist. And in the art world, I think there's probably nothing harder than being a collector and then being known as a collector and then deciding you're going to be an artist. It's kind of like even being the child of a collector, it presents huge hurdles to being perceived as an artist. You know, there are all sorts of very nuanced expectations about what is believable and what's not believable. And so I feel like I have a kind of very complicated and detailed understanding, and which is hard to put in a soundbite. And if you read the book, you know, you'll have what you already know combined with what I learned.
So I didn't run a concordance to the book, but my strong impression is if one were to do a concordance, you'd find that one artist receives more mentions, perhaps by far, than any other artist. Not only in your own mentions, but by the other artists about whom you write.
Yeah.
And that is Jeff Koons. He seems sort of the towering figure in the book and to sort of haunt the entire enterprise. And I wonder if you would agree with that first, and if so, why is it that for almost all of the artists about whom you write, he's such a central point of reference?
Well, he's very much the touchstone. He's so well known that in having conversations with artists about artists, he comes up and they differentiate themselves from him, measure themselves against him. Him and Hearst to some extent, but Hearst maybe only at the beginning of the research for the book. Hearst's star has fallen, shall we say, in a way, you know, I don't think I could say that about Koons, you know, especially with Whitney only just closing. Yeah, he's become an emblematic artist, and others clarify who they are in relation to him. I mean, Ai Weiwei comes up too oddly. In Act One, I go into various artists' studios, and they actually have his sunflower seeds, you know, sitting on their desk, or and bring him up. These are artists who are in the news. They're touchstones. Mm-hmm. I think Koons has mastered the kind of Warholian mode of a kind of paradoxical persona, perhaps better than any other. And I mean, I'm interested not just in personas and masks, but in just one's public self. But the conversation often skips across to the issue of persona.
Yeah. Well, I would just follow that up. I mean, it seemed to me that he was an artist who at once you admired, but absolutely frustrated you.
Yes. Yes. I mean, I think a lot of people who are fans of his work can be frustrated with his persona. You know, he's incredibly slippery. And I would often have to ask him the same question three times to get a semblance of an answer. And it also is kind of a running joke in Act One, actually. You know, him trying to evade direct answers. But I think it's entertaining. I hope it's entertaining, and I also hope that actually, you know, it's. I mean, his discourse is not just gobbledygook. It does make sense, but it's very internal, and he has his own jargon, and you have to kind of unpack it. But it is also very defensive. So, yeah.
Well, I have a lot of other questions to ask, but I think perhaps members of the audience have a few themselves, so perhaps we'll open it up, but I reserve the right to come back to you.
please. And I think there are mics on either side, so please dive in.
Questions?
Microphone?
Yes.
Mics down here? Maybe if they could be prepared, then we can.
Do you have an agenda?
easier if you look here and look back.
I was curious. It seemed to me more about performers and very little about painters and sculptors, and I was just wondering about that.
I think that I'm interested in the performativity of all artists, and it's true the book is not dominated by painters in particular. Carroll Dunham is kind of standing in for your more traditional painter who works alone in the studio. He has an assistant who might gesso the odd canvas, but basically it's just me, myself, and I, as he puts it. And I think that, the Beatriz Mahalez is in Act 3. When Geshe Mutu does collage rather than painting, but talks a lot about painting in her scene in Act 1. I think that the case for painters is a little bit different because a lot of them are, I actually think that Duchamp has shifted the landscape for all artists, but for painters, they can be working with some degree of isolation from that landscape. Someone like Beatriz Mahalez, talks about how Duchamp gave up painting. And she sees herself as continuing on in a tradition, not so much a pre-Duchampian tradition, but certainly one that is about the history of painting. So I think it's a bias of the book to look at the performance of painters as opposed to the painting itself. In the craft section, I do get into the nitty-gritty of making works, but the focus is very much on how artists are garnering attention for their painting as much as just painting.
But isn't there also just the element that many, if not most, of the artists you look at are producing work that in one way or another actually begs the question of what is art, what is an artist?
Yeah.
In a way that perhaps those who engage in more traditional practices of painting and sculpture don't.
That is true. That is true. There's a funny moment in the scene with Yayoi Kusama out in Tokyo. And Kusama, although she does sculpture, and installation, first made her mark as a painter with her infinity net paintings, and now continues. The thing that she really does by herself, for herself, is painting. And there's a moment where the Tate Asia Pacific Acquisitions Committee makes a visit during the course of my time there, and she performs the act of painting in front of an audience. Mm-hmm. That for me is intriguing. I mean, she's, I think that many painters nowadays are expected to do something other as well. And there's a lot of pressure on mm-hmm. young emergent artists to work in multiple media yeah. and to contribute to the dialogue as it's yeah.
I think there's a question at the back of the room on the right side.
Thank you. Do you think that any of these artists will transcend time and 50, 75 years from now we'll be talking about any of them and who?
I think so, but I hate making predictions. I really do. Writing about the art market for The Economist, I was often asked to make predictions about the market, and that's one thing I will never do because it's very unpredictable. But I also think it's hard to know. It really is hard to know because you don't know what an artist is going to do next. I mean, I the oldest artist in the book is Yayoi Kusama. I think she's probably made her mark on art history. It's very tricky. I really hate to answer that question. I mean, I do know that, you know, 7 days in the art world did affect certain people in the book, and sometimes by writing about things and putting things, you know, a book like this puts things into history. So it doesn't mean that it will necessarily have a positive effect, but it at least is a record that's available for people to read in future.
Yes.
Over here, yeah.
I haven't read the book yet, so I apologize if I'm asking a question that's addressed, but I'm curious in looking at what is an artist, if you looked at folk art or the untrained artist and where they fit into the picture.
Well, outsider art is a theme in Act Two, in part because Carroll Dunham and Laurie Simmons and Maurizio Cattelan are very interested in outsider art and actually collect outsider art. And the act starts in Venice and ends in Venice during Massimiliano Gioni's biennial, in which a lot of outsider artists were integrated into the show. And so, I mean, one of the things that intrigues me is that the outsider art world is... there are a lot of things that outsider art that are expected of outsider artists that are not actually even allowed of conceptual contemporary artists, and or they're not de rigueur within that world. So the expectation of outsider artists is that they will their work will be authentic, self-expressionistic outpourings. And that is very much poo-pooed within the conceptual contemporary art world, and particularly in a lot of art schools nowadays. And so it intrigues me that a lot of, and I tend to call professional artists who work within the art world as insider artists, because that's, it seems to me, that's what the outsider artist term suggests. It intrigues me that insider artists, you know, go to outsider artists for this kind of lost world of self-expression in that kind of direct way. And certainly that, that harks back to modern art, or you know, abstract expressionist painting, perhaps, things like that, in a way that the kind of post-Duchampian, post-Warholian conceptual contemporary art world doesn't. But I am looking, you know, the book is about insider artists, I guess you could say. Even if that includes, you know, and that would include teachers, especially artist teachers.
Michael.
Who's the 34th artist? Who didn't make the cut? You
know, I swore to myself that I wouldn't make that public. Because think of it this way, you know, when a curator is putting together a biennial of a group biennial or a group show, they don't then publish the list of artists whose studio that they did studio visits with that they didn't include in the show.
I'll put you on the spot.
There are some really great, important artists on my cutting room floor. And actually artists more famous than the artists who are in the book. But I, you know, I'll give you an example. One of my longtime favorite artists, when I asked him what is an artist, he said an artist makes art. I was like, okay, you know. And he really didn't want to engage with my questions. And my feeling with him was that he had adopted a discourse that was very strategic for him in the late 70s, early 80s, and then stuck with it. And I found his discourse to be kind of dusty and unengaged, and didn't even engage with his own work. Because I think there was a lot of social and political themes in his work, and he actually only wanted to have a formalist conversation about his work. So I still like his work, but possibly less than I did before. It's interesting, actually. It's hard to negate those experiences. So I'm sorry I can't dish on that one. I mean, I know some artists have already talked about the fact that with others through the grapevine, I've heard and it was very painful. The last 10 actually were really, really difficult, and I do hope to write about them in future. Actually, 4 of the people in this book I interviewed for 7 days in the art world and didn't include them. So Damien Hirst, Isaac Julian, and Grayson Perry, and also Massimiliano Joni, who's one of the curators and featured, I interviewed all of them for 7 days in the art world and didn't include them there. So I would hope that, I hope to have the opportunity to write another book.
Yes.
Yeah. Or maybe she's got the mic, so let's go with her and get ready over here.
Hi. You spoke about being a curator and a casting director for this work. Can you sort of talk for just a moment about how you approached the artists? Did you tell them what you were up to? And, you know, how did you sort of get them to open up to you more?
Yes, I believe in being very upfront. I don't think you can like sneak in. Especially, I couldn't sneak in partly because 7 days in the art world was already out in the world, and that actually made my job a lot easier because certain artists had read the book and knew where I was coming from and knew that I wasn't out to get them. That was certainly a factor with Laurie Simmons and Tip Dunham in engendering their trust. They were quite good friends with some of the people in 7 days in the art world. Also, writing for The Economist gave me access, so there were certain artists who wouldn't have talked to me just for the book, perhaps, or I wouldn't have been, like, for example, Jeff Koons very generously gave me an interview for the book, and that is the second scene with him. The first scene is a talk that I attended. But he might not have wanted to see me over and over again, you know, but then I was writing for The Economist, so I got in to see him a few more times. Oh, and actually, very strangely, the Abu Dhabi Art Fair asked me to interview him on stage with Larry Gagosian. So there's a scene in which I'm interviewing Koons on stage with Larry in the Gulf. I was thrilled with that invitation. It worked for me hugely. I think that, you know, there are some interviews that didn't work out so well because they didn't know where I was coming from, or they decided they didn't like my line of questioning, and those are mostly on the cutting room floor. Over here, yeah.
Thank you. I actually have a two-part question. One is, in Sam Hyde's book, Trickster Makes the World.
Sorry, whose book?
Sam Hyde. He did a book called Trickster Makes the World, and it discusses the role of the artist as a trickster that sort of reflects and articulates and catalyzes and challenges society, community, and individual. And one of the things I noticed, I'm a fourth generation art brat, so one of the things I noticed in
your... A fourth generation artist?
Art brat.
Okay, could you be more specific, please?
mother is an artist, father is an artist, grandparents on both sides were creatives, and I've made my living for 20 years as an artist. So, and I moved into that category of interdisciplinary early on. I joke that I'm 100 years old, but early on when I couldn't even have a studio, I had to be in between the sculpture and the painting floor because they didn't have a place for me. I actually had a studio in the stairwell. And I see in my younger people that they're encouraged into interdisciplinary. But having been a trickster myself, or a shapeshifter like most people who have to live a very long creative life, I notice in your selection of artists, just in this, I loved your first book, and I'm sort of a fangirl of yours, that you have chosen artists that their dialogue and even how they've been critiqued is how they're commenting. And do you see the role of artists in contemporary society, even as they become more popular, and you see mergings of like Jeff Koons and H&M becoming truly, truly, truly more catalyzed? He made a t-shirt for H&M. It's, you know, it's a whole, it's Andy Warholian. It's like high, high point. So trickster as artist still relevant is the first question. The second is, I would be interested in the smaller book of Sarah Thornton of the outtakes of her journey of all the other places, like you just mentioned with the Gagosian interview with Jeff Koons, because there is a process behind the process that I would be fascinated in. And that, is that going
to
happen?
That's why you have to come to the talks.
That's why I'm here.
To hear the process behind the process. Well, yeah, I think the trickster is still relevant. I think the key thing for any artist is making the role their own and not inhabiting trickster cliches. So when Maurizio Cattelan resigned from art, retired from art, there was one contingent who said, oh, you know, Duchamp did that too. Gave up making art or ceased to be an artist. For me, I think he's different enough. And the way he went about retiring on the eve of his retrospective was a way of making retirement his own. It's interesting that you're the daughter of an artist, daughter of artists, because oddly, one thing I did find is that, at least with my characters, my artists, a lot of them are the sons and daughters of artists. So Ai Weiwei's the son of an artist, Gabriel Orozco's the son of an artist, a communist muralist. Katie Nolan's the daughter of Kenneth Nolan, and Andrea Fraser's the daughter of an artist who never managed to show her work publicly, but one who worked hard, and that identity dominates Andrea's early childhood memories of her, mother covered in paint. And so I think there's, one of the cultural tropes is the artists rebelling against their parents. But it's not something I've found. And even the artists who don't come from artists, their parents can be quite instrumental in designating them an artist. And so Laurie Simmons tells a story where she, I ask all artists, when did they feel confident declaring themselves an artist? It's one of my questions, and I'm interested in that self-belief. But Laurie walked into kindergarten and said, "Hi, I'm Laurie Simmons, I'm an artist." I think it was partly a parental designation, because she was kind of a chaotic kid who, with a messy room and seemed a bit disorganized. And it was a way of, giving her a designation that it kind of explained away her nonconformity. And I do think that happens quite a bit. Although it's actually something I don't, and I write about that in the book, something I don't write about in the book, but I think is true in like very conservative cultures like the Middle East, is, the gay son can be the artist. And so it is a way of framing difference sometimes and trying to make it okay.
So, just reminds me, I spoke once with a Hollywood casting director who told me her secret was always to look for the children of actors or actresses.
Interesting.
Yeah. But I want to follow up on a sort of that behind the scenes question. One detail that interested me was in the Katie Nolan chapter.
Yes.
The note at the bottom where it said something to the effect of Ms. Nolan asks it to be made known that she has not approved this chapter or this.
Yes.
And that suggested to me that perhaps the other artist had approved their. No.
Actually, there are at least three artists who did not want to be in the book who are in the book. Mm-hmm. But Katie was the only one with whom I had to fact check with lawyers. And she's very well known for that, actually. And if you see her work installed almost anywhere, there's usually a plaque on the wall that says, Ms. Noland or does not approve of this installation, or this is not done with her consent. Or yes, she was the only one who wanted it known.
Okay.
And I have to be very careful what I say, but I think when you read that scene, it will be explained.
Yeah. Do you have a final
question? How about two more, if that's all right, if we can manage it.
Since you have written for The Economist, I guess this is a fair question. How is some of this work monetized?
How is some of this work monetized?
How do these people eat?
Yeah. Well, most of
it's not a very art question, but
because most of the artists in the book have high levels of recognition, quite a few of them are very wealthy. And so the kind of cliche of the struggling, starving artist is really, obviously there are artists. Artists are, I believe, if you look at statistics, the most downwardly mobile category of worker in American culture. So there's this strange situation where there's great downward mobility and making ends meet, and also extreme wealth at the other end. Obviously, it depends what kind of work they make. Painting is the main commodity form of the art market. And painters tend to fare better than others. Performance art is not so lucrative. Video often requires backers, and that would be additioned usually, so you can spread out the additions amongst the backers, that kind of thing. I get into that a little bit in Act 3, Craft. Because money talks so loudly and prices are one of the few ways that that art gets out of the arts pages, I was keen to delay a discussion of the market till the end of the book. Obviously, it's hard to talk Coons without talking about the market a little bit. But it was important to me to run the questions and the themes and explore anything without making it a big topic until the end. Just so we can remember some of the other things that art brings. I have a friend who's a psychoanalyst who doesn't think he likes contemporary art, but because he's a friend of mine, he read the book and he got hold of an early edition because it came out in Britain before the US. And he sat down and read it fairly quickly, and he was amazed at how interesting contemporary art was. Partly because he thought it was just like a kind of glitzy luxury good for rich people, and so he was really amazed at like these themes coming out and the kind of work that artists were doing in Act 1 and Act 2 in particular. Really engaged him. And so I'm keen to write for people outside the art world and grow the audience for contemporary art just in synergy with museums who try to do the same thing, you know. And so it was important for me to, it seemed those themes are very important and they're not typical of a art forum special issue, and they're not typical of art criticism either. And it seemed exciting for me to look at art through those filters. And I'm so sorry, but the lady behind you had her hand up first, if that's all right.
Thank you. My question is more along the lines of considering globalization of the contemporary art market. And I wonder about language. If you chose artists who you could communicate with directly versus through translators. And the reason I ask is that I just spent 6 months in Milan and around northern Italy. And there was one conversation with an artist, and you know, half of us spoke Italian and half didn't. And I remember the translator translating some things, and like, that's not what he said. And so there was this interpretation, and I wonder if you only chose artists you could communicate with directly, and if you could open it up to more of a global representation, if you trusted a translator?
I had to use translators with Yayoi Kusama and also with Lu Qing, Ai Weiwei's wife, because when I visited, in one of the scenes, I've arranged to visit Ai Weiwei in the studio, and he gets put into prison just before I arrive. And I have what I think is actually a pretty poignant moment with his wife, who's seriously distressed about his disturbance. With regard to Kusama, I had an interpreter. There was an interpreter in the room, and I also tape recorded everything, and then I had it re-translated. And the gap between the interpretation and the translation was enormous. And I think it's partly because Japanese culture is so polite, and she's not necessarily observant of all of those etiquettes, and sometimes comes across as a little wingy, and possibly egotistical as well, in a way that a translator, an interpreter in the room would feel rude, you know? And so it was very interesting to have the comparison between what the interpreter said she said, and then what I realized she said a few weeks later, once I'd had, and I obviously went with what she actually said, you know. But otherwise, it is biased towards those who spoke English. But amazingly, a lot of these artists do speak English, and English is the lingua franca of the global art world, which is highly internationalized. You know, to the extent that Wengeshi Mutu, you know, talks about contemporary art as a bit of a foreign import. And so there's, you know, an art scene in Nairobi, but a lot of those artists spend a lot of time abroad and go back and forth. And she was educated, I think she did A levels in the UK and then went to Yale, you know.
So I think time has been called, but I want to again thank you.
Thank you very much. And thank you, Jeremy.